through the mists comes forth RPG a day. In the year 2021, RPG a day comes back for its 8th year. A time in August when every day we tackle another question or topic by answering in a way that uplifts the gaming community and answers questions people might have about this crazy hobby of ours that serves to build the community and bring it up, that many of us make blogs about, video blogs, art, or great works. In celebration of the community of gamers, I welcome you to RPG A Day 2021. Hello friends, I am Rob, the Dungeon Tutor, also sometimes Omnisci. And today, we're doing another RPG A Day video for the year 2021. It is the penultimate day, the day before the end. And today's topic word is mention. Now, in this case, I'm going to be a little self-indulgent. And I thought with this video, I would mention various people in the industry who kind of helped get me to where I'm at. I might throw a little shade around, too, at a few people. So, nothing too terrible. Don't have to worry, I'm in a pretty good mood today. So, let's begin. Mention, honorable mention, goes to, well, Gary Gygax. One of the creators and probably one of the most brilliant salespeople for role-playing games. He helped to make the gaming industry what it is today. It would be a lie to say that the role-playing game hobby would be where it is today if it wasn't for him. I'm not saying it wouldn't exist, because other games were coming out. It seemed like several people were coming on to the idea of a more hero-based fighting game, more so than war games with large units going up against each other. And eventually, different people had taken elements from Tolkien or the sci-fi, and were already coming up with their own things at around the same time that Gygax and company were. But without the lightning rod that was Dungeons & Dragons, so many writers, so many creators, and so many people who enjoy these games might never have cottoned on to the hobby, and it would be in definitely a more infant stage than it is today. So he deserves a lot of credit for that. I'm not saying that he is the only one that should be credited at all. I'm not even saying he's the only one who should be credited for the concept of Dungeons & Dragons. Because while he might have come to something like that, it was inspired by, the works of Arneson and others around him. But, all in all, I still like to give credit to Gary because he is, I think, one of the tent poles of where gaming is. And I respect that. And having had the opportunity to meet him once, you could tell he really loved the community, he loved the gamers, and, being in a position where he could have brought this to us. So, honorable mention goes to him. Honorable mention goes to Eric Tenkar, the voice of the old school renaissance or old school renewal of basically people who love the classic gaming principles of original Dungeons & Dragons. Proof that people love it is there have been so many retro clones made from Adventures Dark and Deep that takes an angle of what would have been like if Gary had continued to evolve Dungeons & Dragons. Or Labyrinth Lord, which is basically, let's take the old Dungeons & Dragons rules, refresh them, polish up the language, and just try to put a more modern spin on them. Swords and Wizardry, which took a more simplistic approach to the early days and then allows you to add on to that and grow it out and develop. Like if the Moldvayne Holmes basic expert set had continued on as the sets eventually came to. But, ideas of still keeping it fairly simple and allowing you to tell exactly the kind of story using those old rules. Lots of people love those rules. And Eric Tenkar is kind of our voice for that. He's a very hard worker as far as podcasting and making his blogs. Although he's kind of slipped a little bit on the blog side, he's fallen in love with podcasting and, God bless him for it. But he is a diligent worker in trying to present everything that is good about old school rules out before everybody and alerting everyone when there's bad actors on the scene. I consider him to be a friend, even though we've only met once face to face, no, twice now. But he's a really good guy, and as I've kind of gotten to know him and become a fan of his, I really can't do anything to take away from the fact that he is one of the most respected people in the industry right now as far as the blogosphere, to a point where a lot of gamers really do value his opinion and his presence. Even though he is an annoying gadfly to the people who are bad actors and sometimes clashes with people, I find that it's usually the worst sort that are the ones that are likely to do that with him. So, and on the flip side of that dishonorable mention are a lot of the people he's irked, mostly because their disingenuous actions have caused them to screw a lot of people. And Eric, having been a New York cop, he doesn't go for that. So, people like Ken Whitman, also known as Whit Whitman, he's launched numerous Kickstarters that seemingly never really had any desire to fulfill, including some fairly high-profile ones, having also messed with another person who will be mentioned shortly as far as his Knights of the Dinner Table live action. That didn't work out. Gareth Skarka, who is a contributor on numerous role-playing games. He does have some impressive credentials. When it comes to running a Kickstarter and fulfilling, not so good. Not so good. His one game that he promised, Far West, is years and years and years and years late, to the point where people almost don't believe he'll put in anything on that anymore. Honorable and dishonorable mention. Is that legal to do? Well, okay. Frank Mentzer. Again, one of the... you can almost say he's a tentpole figure in gaming. He was the one successful basic Dungeons & Dragons version. Mulvey & Holmes was kind of a start and a stop. With Mentzer, his version went all the way up to basic expert companion masters immortal sets. Covering the full scope of the adventuring experience for Dungeons & Dragons. He made the game approachable, he made it a very good read, he made it so that it introduced a lot of people into Dungeons & Dragons, and therefore into the gaming world in general. Lots of us, including myself, owe his work for bringing us into gaming. On the other hand, he's a bit of an egocentric jerk. I've kind of tangled with him, never trying to start problems, but he's very easy to offend, and he's got some things out there that don't look really good, if you look. So, you know, I beg of you, if you enjoy a person's work, don't necessarily attach the person themselves to it. Enjoy the work, but you don't necessarily have to love the creator. And, you know, I've even been to his house and had a pleasant time at a party he threw. But he's just so easy to trigger off because he's so proud and pretty arrogant that, you know. So, I do like Frank's stuff. Sometimes he's a little hard to handle. On the other side, Alphinius Goo and the GUI Cube community. What can I say? They gave me my chance at being published, and I'm getting published, which is awesome. They're still offering me work because they like what I do, which makes me feel really good. I can't thank them enough for what they've done for me, but I can also objectively as I get, say that, and I can show you, their works are top-notch. They look beautiful. They, you know, put a lot of value into the stuff they give you when you buy their works. So I could definitely say without a shadow of a doubt that they are a group that's taking a different path from a lot of others, and are generally doing a really good job with what they've got. Will they succeed? Will they fail? I don't know, honestly. The role-playing game landscape is littered with the corpses of companies with the best of intentions and sometimes radical approaches that just couldn't sustain. Now, GUI Cube has survived the COVID virus epidemic, which that's pretty good. That's, if they've survived and they actually seem like they're doing pretty well, that's great. A lot of companies folded with that. So I'm hoping that they keep going and keep getting stronger and that they bring me along for the ride because it's been fun so far. But they're good folk, and I definitely think that you should be interested in a group like that if you love fantasy gaming with a different spin. The fact also that their stuff is a little bit darker than D&D standard is kind of nice. They don't go full Ravenloft, but it's quite clear that there are some bad things, and bad things happen in their stories, so they work so hard at trying to get you invested in them that in some cases I think that even a game like Call of Cthulhu could take notes from some of what they do. So, that being said, I'd also like to throw out a nod to companies like Modiphius and, to a certain amount, Chaosium. These game companies are still around. They've been around for a while and been producing a lot of really good content. Chaosium from the very early days, and they've added to the landscape significantly. They've never approached the level of TSR and then Wizards of the Coast, but they have a dedicated community, a solid fan base, and they've got some very good intellectual properties that they continue to develop and evolve, which is commendable. They're not magpies that just take stuff, work with it, and then just leave it behind and go on to the next thing, which I like. Modiphius has taken some interesting intellectual properties, taken their own proprietary dramatic game systems, really added them and made those franchises that otherwise would be moldering and not doing anything, and really made them sing. I didn't think after the Disney movie that did only so-so with John Carter would actually have a role-playing game that would say, okay, that movie was good. Let's go back to the original Edgar Rice Burroughs stories of a two-fisted hero who goes out and dares to do great things and can be phenomenally successful, as John Carter from Mars, the stories originally had. And they, for the most part, these games are really interesting and exciting. They got Conan, and they made probably one of the more compelling Conan games that I've read through. So, and I'm a fan of Conan too, and I, you know, would wince if I saw somebody take a shot at that franchise and not do very well with it. So I really am kind of cheered to see some of these companies taking some of these franchises. I guess I would be remiss if I didn't mention Free League at this point too, because what they've done with some of these franchises that they've had access to, Aliens. A lot of people seem to really like that game, and yeah, I'm going to get around to reviewing that soon. But what I've seen with Twilight 2000, again, taking their system and plugging it on, and I'm familiar with the old system, and now I've seen their new system, and I'm actually kind of excited for this. I want to see what they do with some of these franchises that are just kind of languishing out there. And even their Tales from the Loop is kind of exciting, now that I've read through some of that. I'm like, oh, okay. This actually could be really exciting for even a group of experienced gamers, or introducing a whole new way of playing to a younger group. This is gold that they've come up with. And again, their own game system that they keep changing and altering to fit these different styles. Very cool. And I'm pretty high on Free League right now. And this is not to say that other companies like Trollord Games aren't still ticking around, and they are. Goodman Games, they seem to have as much fun reprinting classic games from TSR's old library as they do continuing to make things in their Dungeon Crawl Classics and Mutant Crawl Chronicles and all these different games. They're still solid companies that are putting out great stuff. And if you look through the average hobby shop at the role-playing game section, you can often find these companies well-represented because they have a lot of products out there. They're giving some writers some jobs, and that's cool. I may not be a patron of their things, but I have to acknowledge that they're doing right by the community. So that's good. But also what I love to show forth is all of these new games coming out from all these different avenues that don't fit classic gamer styles. I mean, My Little Pony Friendship is Magic. You know, the Tales of Equestria game, I keep hearing people say this is a really good game, and it fits a need that a lot of people have had for an approachable game that kids can enjoy and adults can play along with them and not feel embarrassed about. With basic concepts like friendship and loyalty, and still, you know, overcoming strife and difficulty. You know, goodness knows there are some real universal themes that you can explore in games like that. For people who loved, anthropomorphic animals in their games, they've had games like Ironclaw out for a while. But now I've seen, you know, all these games that are coming out, like Mouse Guard and Pugmire and even Call of Cthulhu, that are, you know, helping out, finding new niches for people who are interested in games and giving them something they can play. Many of them have their own quirky little spins to them, of course, but I'm really kind of happy to see these games coming out, because that means that other people come in, this might be the tag that brings them in, and then once they get into role-playing, they might be, okay, that's an interesting experience, what else is out there? And might find other games, too, that might draw them to my table someday, which I think is pretty cool. Of course, the old franchises that are still out there, there's Ulysses now has Warhammer 40,000, so that's still around. The Warhammer Fantasy game is still out there, so those are still chugging along. I know that there's so many franchises out there, I can't keep track of them all. I mean, Doctor Who is well represented with their slick looking game, and Dresden Files has always got some people who are always recommending that to me from different social media channels. I've also had an opportunity to get into some that I hadn't been before, like Loot Crane's Burning Wheel and Savage Worlds now I'm getting into. So, you know, the gaming landscape keeps evolving, and there are some excellent games out there, and I can't wait to explore more of them. It's a very exciting time to be a gamer, quite honestly, with more and more games coming out and some going in very exotic directions that allow you new vistas that previously you wouldn't even have imagined. I'm very excited by this stuff. So those are the mentions I thought I would give out as far as the role-playing games. Tangentially, I'd like to throw out a little love for the somewhat deceased. He's brought it to an end, but there was an excellent webcomic called Schlock Mercenary that eventually did spawn a role-playing game called Planet Mercenary. It's written by and illustrated by Howard Taylor, who's an interesting fellow. Very smart. His style evolved over the course of many years as he wrote out his comic. And if you've never seen it before, you have days and days and days worth of reading to catch up on. But it was a really good comic that he published, and I'm, you know, sure he made a pretty good living off of it. It was very smart and very well done. So I like to throw a little love out there. It's also on my bucket list to run a Planet Mercenaries game at some point in the very near future. Monty Cook, the mad genius of role-playing games. So many people really seem to love his stuff with his Cypher system, which is kind of a somewhat universal system with a very different spin what most people take in a universal system. And also keeping an eye out for a variety of fan bases, including his No Thank You Evil series, which is targeted for kids, which I think is great. There needs to be more games for kids to bring them into a more imaginative way of enjoying themselves rather than just plugging into Fortnite and YouTube. So, good on you. I may not always like your games, Monty, but you're a good guy and you're on the list. And also there's a lot of people that you support. You've put out works from other people, and that's really cool. Kind of glad for that. So, those are the mentions I'm going to give. I could keep going on and on and on and on and on. I don't want to do that. I would like to give a few shout-outs, though, to my friend Rick Hilliard on the Your Place at the Table, or Your Seat at the Table. making out videos based on the roleplay games that he has, is reviewing them. He's got a really down-home style, which is stripped of artifice. He says it like he sees it, and covers a variety of classic books. Right now, I believe he's primarily focusing on Middle-earth role-playing games and Star Wars, the role-playing game from West End Games. So, awesome content that he is making. Big thumbs up for that. I like to shout out for him every now and again because I think his stuff is really cool. Also, if you haven't seen it and you like to laugh, the works of Puffin Forest on YouTube. The guy is a lot of fun. He animates stuff his own style, and he's got a unique voice that just kind of draws you in, which is actually his voice, which, I thought it was an affectation, but no. It draws you in. He's got a fun sense of humor. I highly recommend looking his stuff. As far as current role-playing game channels, Ginny D., she's already got a large following. She's very talented, puts out a lot of great content for Dungeons & Dragons, especially seems to care more about the role-playing of it and getting into character and giving everybody a good experience. So good on her. She's cute. She's fun. She's smart. She's worth looking at. I'm not going to give you a lot of live streams and those plays. I don't watch those, but there's a number of them out there. If you're looking to get into a particular game, I recommend looking those up. So, those are my mentions, and I know it was a little long. Thank you for sticking with them. Maybe you found something new along this, though, and want to go check it out. So it wouldn't sadden me to see you throw some love out to those folks, except for the con artists that I talked about, like Whitman and Skarka. But you do you. If you have too much money, they'll help you out with that. Further videos. Thanks for joining me again. Second to the last day, so I've got one more left for RPG a day, and then on to all the dungeon tutors that I've got ready to go, and the other Lair of Omnisci content, including an exciting video coming up with a character witness. So if you're looking forward to that, I hope you are. We'll see you soon. As always, feel free to leave comments below. Anybody that I mentioned that you disagree with, or somebody you think I should have mentioned, feel free. We'll carry on a conversation about that. Like and subscribe. If this is the first time you've seen me. I appreciate the community, and I'm always looking to add more content for you guys. And that's about all I have to say. So thanks for joining me, and as Rob the Dungeon Tutor, or Omnisci, farewell.